staff of Fiji National University, young people in green, present here, Youth for Integrity Fiji, and of course, ladies and gentlemen, assalamu alaikum, good afternoon. And let me say, happy festivities. I won't say Merry Christmas yet. Christmas is some weeks away. But I want to say it's my honor to share the stage today with my former lecturer and one of the best I had. And I think my teaching career wouldn't have been my pinnacle of success if I had not gone through Fiji College of Advanced Education training that time. And Professor Bamba was my education lecturer. As always, like, I always fancied her, younger. Younger, when I see due respect, I fancied her. I used to wear heels like her. And the way she, I'm telling you the truth, I haven't said this. The way she would walk on the corridor with that confidence, you know? And that pulled me towards her, and probably that's what inspired me to learn from her. One phase. You know, advanced school at that time, we didn't have AC and stuff, the fan. I'm talking about 1992, 93, I was there. And so she'd walk in the lecture theater, you know, young, Unaisi. Can you imagine her? Full of life. And she'd come, and she would say this thing that I still say now. And let me say it again, no offense, no dis. She'd come and say, the fan in a hand or the paper in a hand, or salivinakitikata, you know? And I didn't know what it meant till some years later. I found it very hot. It meant very hot. So sometimes, oh, salivinakitikata, you know, like that. The accent, I still remember accent, madam. So I just want to say that we as educators make a huge impact on the lives of our students. And that's the underlying, what should I say, moment of truth for any educator. For any educator, you must know what's in the heart of your students. You must inspire them, otherwise it's a lost cause. Teaching is a lost cause if you are not able to get the attention and the respect of your students. It's very important. And I know thousands and thousands of students would have gone under your teaching over the whatever span of teaching years you have. And now you're qualified people. Mrs. Singh, I remember from her practicum days. And when I decided to become a teacher, it was a deep conviction. I really wanted to be a teacher. 1989, when I finished my Form 7, that time Fiji was facing an acute teacher shortage. And the government and the Minister of Education was hand-picking students who had finished Form 7. So I worked hard. I passed Form 7 with some very good marks in certain subjects. And one of that was English. I topped Xavier in English. And the other one was in geography. So one of the local schools picked me up from my marks because they're Xavier students. And they said, go and teach. So 89, I finished Form 7. 90, I was at Basanathan teaching English and social science. No training. I was just pushed into that, maybe because I so badly wanted to be a teacher. For 3 years, I taught. And I think the records there stand for itself. It was my passion that made me no training, no qualification. I did my best. And guess what I was paid then? $5,304. Just last night, I took out my contract letter. It was a grant in aid that time. I actually wanted to bring it here. I thought there was going to be students there. Inspired by that. That time, I didn't care about the wages. I did everything. And then, in 3 years later, we were put to advanced college. We were chosen to go for training by the government. And I don't regret a single moment, a single day I spent with my students. I have students all across. So when I started traveling, when I took over Women, Children, and Poverty Alleviation 2014, I traveled a lot of places, and I met some of those students. You know how happy, how proud it makes you feel that you have a student out there who you taught, the values, the teachings, everything, the skills, he carries with you. So as educators, whether you are in a university, whether you are in a school system, I think it's very important you teach with passion. You may I was just sitting there and asking about how much does each person get paid. You may not be paid as much as you'd expect, but you have a calling. It's a very noble calling. Teaching is a very noble, very respectful profession. So whatever you do it in your classroom, in your university, I'm sure your students are going to be proud of you. Nevertheless, ladies and gentlemen, I just got off track, but I'm very happy to be here. And I think it's a Christmas function, and you've timed it very well with the launch of your programs. And so here we are. What are we going to do? We are going to launch, the College of Humanities and Education has developed new programs in sports education and exercise science. Something new, eh? Exercise science. Exercise science and sports goes very together. Counseling, special and inclusive education, in addition to other offerings, which is going to be launched. These subjects, if you look at it, I think there's a very core, it's the heart of teaching, counseling. Sometimes we think that teachers do teaching, and counselors come and do counseling. No, it's not. Every teacher must be a counselor. Every teacher must be a counselor. You must know how to handle your students, whether they are university students or whether they are going to, where these teachers who are going to take this course. It doesn't have to be teachers who are going to take this course. This course is open to anybody who wants to be in that field. Counseling is one area that is highly in demand. Highly in demand. And I don't know how many of us were prepared when COVID hit us. We can't forget COVID. COVID came and messed up everything. I think we are still reeling from what COVID did to us, wearing of masks, staying home, 2 meter distance, don't go here, don't travel. It stressed us. Everybody was stressed. Now we are slowly opening up, but that doesn't mean the danger is over yet. We are not out of the woods yet. So counseling is one thing that we all needed. I mean, I wish somebody came and sat with me and spoke to me. Rosie, how are you going to deal with this situation? How are you going to run a ministry remotely? No, because I'm not a counselor. I think I'm a teacher. I think I'm a teacher still. But now that I've got that ministerial position, everything goes away. How do I deal with it? How do children deal with it? How did you deal with this? Scared, eh? Scared, eh? Or my wages may be slashed because I'm not teaching, online teaching. How many of us were prepared for remote teaching? This Zoom came in, then Teams came in. I mean, I was hearing about Zoom. What is this Zoom virtual thing like that? We all had an opportunity to learn something like that. It changed our lives. It changed how we saw tomorrow. Or how we, I mean, I don't know what's going to happen with the third phase coming in. So as educators, it is your responsibility to be advisors as well, right? And when these courses are going to be offered to our students, I'm sure it's going to benefit them well. It's just like what we need now. Maybe it's too late to start, but we've started it. I mean, who would have thought that counseling would be so much in demand? Why do we need sports education and exercise science? Look at the health issues we have, very important. And of course, special and inclusive education. Everything that we do these days has to be inclusive. So we launched this second phase of I Am Digital campaign just now before coming here with Save the Children's Fund. And there we are saying women, girls, disabled persons have to be included in everything. So that's what inclusive education is. How do we include them in our daily lives? How do we put them on the same platform? So here would be people who are going to be trained into that. And I encourage school leavers or those who are interested in this, take up this because of the demand. The second thing I want to talk about is the passion that we need to have when we follow our career. You've got all these nice, beautiful courses designed and trialed and tested, resources all done. But the person who's going to enroll for that course must have passion for that. Oh, I want to be a counselor, not that I want a job. Not that I want a job. We've made it so easy. We've made it so easy for students, especially high school students, to get into programs. When I was with education, I thought that people saw teaching as an alternate job. If you are going to do a BA, plain BSc, and you don't get a job anywhere else, they would come for teaching. But you can't have teachers who don't have passion. And I'm sure those that are already in the system are very passionate about their jobs. They've done wonders during COVID time. I worked with them during COVID time. They traveled hours to see the children. They traveled hours and by road, by horseback, by river to deliver materials. And that's what education is all about for me, having the passion to do right by your job, by the career that you choose. Right, so education, if I can just say that, has been the top priority of the Fijian government. Okay, a lot of budgetary allocations has been done so that we subsidize children's education, we take off the burden of the parents, and it's the onus is on the parents to ensure that the children go to school. So we have the tertiary education loan scheme, the topper scholarship, and so we have that. Unfortunately, during my time with education, I found out that some students did not perform, even toppers did not perform. They would leave halfway. So that's not where education sector should be going. With opportunities available, it is important that young people like all our green warriors sitting here, right, grab those opportunities. We didn't have it. We used to do one unit summer school. I mean, some of you from my age, probably I'll be 50 in 2 weeks' time, when we were in school, we do one summer school, one extension. You walk, we teach and then do that, teach and do that. But we managed to attain our degrees and postgrad the hard way. Our parents had to pay the fees. But look at these young people of Fiji today. Lots of opportunities, okay? So make the best use of it. And I'm also pleased to note that the School of Communication, Language and Literature is working on an English proficiency refresher program, and it's targeting educators. It's very important, right? And I'm sure that can be utilized by any other civil servant. Communication, you communicate in English wherever you are. So this could be a good avenue for other civil servants, other people who want to increase the English proficiency. And well, I'm also Dr. Sakul Kundra, who I worked with in my previous unit last semester, has been doing a lot as well, publishing articles, and he doesn't stop in sending one article to me. I published this, madam, would you like to read it? So we get encouragement from that as well. And then we have, let me just say it in my own words. You know, when these people write for me, I don't understand what they're doing. So at a time when we are facing challenges of COVID-19 and the socioeconomic impact that has caused in Fiji and over the globe, we have continued to invest in education. Our national university, even during this time, kept its operations on, right? And I'm sure we've learned a lot from where to go and how to go in future. And we had our development partners coming to our aid in assisting the continuity of the examination, the university. I'm sure all of you received your pay, there was no pay cut, et cetera. That's the biggest threat we have, eh? That's the biggest worry we have when there are uncertainties. Is my job secure? Teachers were calling and asking me, we are home for so many months, are you going to deduct our pay? I mean, that's basic survival, and COVID taught us to look after our own selves first. How do we survive? How do we look after children? How do we look after families? And that's the truth of the moment. We all were scared for our livelihoods. Definitely, we were all scared for our children. How are you gonna feed them? And of course, we were scared for our country as well. If we sink further down into the impacts of COVID-19, what's gonna happen? So now we are happy, flights are coming on, visitors are coming in our country. Work has started, slowly and slowly we are normalizing, but please keep your guards up. Eh? Keep advocating for health protocols, etc. That's very important. And I had a bit of, good news from the Department of Creative Arts. You have completed a very successful rural women's entrepreneurial income generating project. That's also very important. As we close the gaps to the 16 days of activism on violence against women and all stuff like that, economic empowerment of women, I think your department plays a very important role in helping us address gender inequalities. I strongly believe if a woman is financially independent, she will be able to solve the many problems that comes about with gender violence and all these things. So congratulations on that. And I know there's a lot and lot of things that I would like Professor Bamba to talk about, but my presence here was just to say thank you for the work that you do. And that's technology for us. It's okay, you can take your call. I'll wait. But Anyway, ladies, you look very, very rosy, I would say, with red. And gentlemen, a few in number, but you do matter to us. And I just like to wish you wish you well with all these programs, and I hope that the departments achieve good success, and we'll be waiting for the graduates to graduate and come out and join the workforce. Wish you well in that. Well, thank you all, and let me say, now I will say Merry Christmas and a very Happy New Year. And I don't get a chance to celebrate Christmas. I just don't have time, I'm sorry. But you, sorry MC, you said you will compensate the absence from my family. I don't know how you're gonna do that. But, and he's, oh, you're gonna dance for me? You're keeping me away from my, you're keeping me away from my grandson. So it's.
My grandson is an emotional.
But anyways, thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Please enjoy the rest of the time, and God bless you all.